Hey, Joshua.
Yes, that's me.
Hey, how you doing, man?
How's it going?
Good. So you've been a friend of Richard for a while?
Yeah, I've known Richard for a long time.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I said you're interested in having a little debate or discussion about evolution theory.
I was thinking more of like a discussion, I guess.
Yeah.
See where it goes. More of a discussion. I saw your video of the the dinosaur bones. I would mind touching on that either.
Okay. Did you see my video or where I was talking or one of the calls or podcasts where I was talking about it?
Yeah, it was on YouTube.
Oh, so you saw the dinosaur hunter video about
right, yes.
The guy finding
the bones for the museum or whatever.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, so you're Joshua and you're out of do you live near Richard or in Arizona? Or?
From Long Island. No, I know him from Long Island. He used to live here.
Oh, okay. Cool, yeah. So you're from Long Island, and
yeah,
I'm just trying to get an introduction here, and you're a friend of Richard's, and yeah, so you saw my video about dinosaur hunters, and then have you listened to any of my critique on evolution theory or anything?
No, I haven't. I was trying to find stuff on YouTube. That's generally, I know it sounds kind of stupid, but that's a lot of times where I listen to like podcasts. It's like what people upload on YouTube just because it's like a lot easier, more convenient, sort of.
Yeah.
So he was telling me about it. I don't know exactly 100% where you stand on it. I know he said you had some questions that most people couldn't answer.
Well, yeah, stuff like yeah. That. Yeah, I mean, what is your background as far as... you somebody that's just like a layman that's interested in the evolution theory and have kind of studied up on it, or do you have any like credentials or anything? Formal training?
No, basically I've been interested in like animals my entire life. I read for something I'm interested in. I thought about taking it up as a career, but I never really panned out. But I've read tons of books, watched tons of documentaries, read a lot. Every time there's news on a new discovery, I read about it. So it's not something I'm really interested in.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I just was wondering what your particular, because a lot of people you'll get into a discussion with, you know, that believe in evolution, like it's sort of like one of those things that's been proven by science. I think that's pretty common. And then you kind of get into it a bit with them, and then they kind of refer you to an expert because, you know, sometimes but it's still this belief. It's kind of like where a lot of times I've noticed it kind of comes down to an acceptance of an authority telling you that something is so. And then I'm not saying that that's where you're coming from. I'm just saying that's been my experience in the past, but yeah.
Well, I believe if you're gonna believe in a concept, you should you could read about it from somebody, but you should also be able to kind of understand it, like read it, say, oh, that makes sense, and not just assume it's true. Like it has to like it's a lot of it does seem like kind of crazy, like the different forms and species. It's a pretty wide variety of things in the
yeah.
world. So
right.
it is kind of, I could see sometimes, even I was like thinking, well, that's like insane how something could, one thing could spawn from so many things. So, I believe it has to make sense. There has kind of a leap of faith, lack of a better term.
Yeah.
It just depends. Like, I feel like when someone brings up evolution, their mind goes immediately to like humans, and that kind of like offends them because they don't want to think that they're part of everything,
right?
Especially people, right? Like that's what their mind goes, like, oh, humans, well, I don't know about dogs or bears or whatever, but I know I know that, like, I didn't come from that. So when usually when I think of evolution, since I'm, like, thinking of all these other different species, I hardly ever relate it to myself until I realize that that's what most people relate it to. And human evolution is definitely interesting and studied. I'm not saying it's not, but it's not the first thing I think of. And I think it is the first thing that most people think of. They think of evolution as, like, people. That's, like, you know, it's kind of like a knock on them, especially if they're very religious.
But I mean, well, I guess it'd be a good time to, like, you know, define evolution. I've had discussions before with people where it kind of progresses along, and then I'll say something like, okay, so you know, you're saying that, you know, human beings came from a common ancestor with a, you know, a turnip or something like that. It makes it sound silly, but at the same time, that is what evolution, you know, because I think the scientific term is common descent. So everything has a common ancestry. And then a lot of times I get this rebuttal of, like, no, that's not what I believe. So I guess, like, I would just ask you, like, what, so when you're talking about, when you say evolution, what do you mean?
It depends on how, like, right, what you're saying is, I think actually is what most scientists go with.
Yeah, that's what I think too, yeah.
Yeah, 100%. I think it's, if you have, like, a family tree, lack of a better term, of, like, species, of, like, what species are related to, how closely, you could feasibly get everything down to one thing.
Yeah, so it all, and connect. Then, like, I think the common idea that's put out there is we all came from, like, rock soup 4.5 billion years ago, and then things kind of came together, came into a one-celled, and then kind of just progressed out of there. And then when I say that, like, I noticed, too, that kind of is off-putting to some people. It's like, no, I don't believe that. It's like, well, yeah, that's pretty much what the science, from what I understand, that's what they're saying. It's like, it's everything is sort of a product of, when it comes down to it, when you're trying to define the mechanism, it's what the way it's described is random, a random process.
To me, it's an evolving science, you know, like, not to use a pun there, but it's like, it's not, I don't think that it's all figured out. But I do believe the common, that is the theory, though, that everything did come from one thing. But I don't think that, and I'm pretty sure I could be wrong in this, but I think most scientists would claim that they don't know everything.
Yeah.
There is some still things to, that they're finding out. It's not just like, oh yeah, this is definitely this, but I do think, yeah, that is basically the thing, that the common theory that everything came from one thing and it kind of spawned off that way.
Yeah, so the way I understand it is Darwin's theory of evolution says that the and see if you disagree with this, it's that everything comes from a common ancestor through a process of gradual accumulation of imperceptibly small changes over millions and millions of years by way of random mutation and natural selection. Would that pretty much summarize it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, well, let me ask you this. Have you ever looked at, there was a recent... a guy recently did it. He did an experiment on the silver fox.
Okay.
Are you familiar with that?
I'm not familiar with the experiment, no.
So yeah, is this a Russian guy? And he's taken silver fox, which is a species of fox, and he's domesticated them. And so it's sort of an investigation into how long, you know, this process takes to get a domesticated type of a dog out of a wild species. So he's taking them from the wild and he's domesticating them. And so I've read up on that. And according to what they're talking about, it's like within 10 years they had practically had domesticated the silver fox. After they said 40 years, they had fully domesticated the silver fox. The silver fox had droopy ears, kind of mottled fur, and docile, and were good with kids. And so it was let's just say 40 years of going from a wild silver fox to like a something very akin to a domesticated dog. So I don't. So would you agree with like that? Something like that is. I mean, do you have any issues with that? The way you're understanding evolution?
You know what? Now you're saying it, that does sound familiar. I believe that's a form of like kind of like microevolution, like not evolution per se, but it is showing it's a species can change. Is it a different species? The fox, not necessarily. I mean, a fox and a wolf are related. They're both in like the Canis family, but they're not the same thing. But a dog and wolf are obviously really closely related. They can interbreed, but I believe the domestic dog is now like a subspecies of a wolf, or depending on who you ask, is a completely different species.
Yeah.
So, like I said, in a way, that's kind of like, it's not proving everything, but it's proving that species can change.
I think another thing that it proves too is that you can have some pretty substantial changes in, you know, morphology, the ears, the whole disposition of the animal, being able to domesticate it 40 years. That's not taking, right. It's not taking thousands or thousands of years. It's not taking millions of years. It's not even taking anything close. But then you'll have people argue that, oh, you're an idiot if you don't believe in evolution, because here's evolution right here in front of you. And it's like, well, that's why I go back to the definition. If your definition of evolution is slow accumulating changes imperceptible over vast ages of time, that doesn't fit that definition. And see, that's why I think that, like, somebody could say the word evolution means completely something completely different than what they think it means. So so that's obviously an example where that's not what you think it means, because that's not a slow, gradual, accumulated, random mutations over vast aeons of time. That can't possibly be. But that's selective. That would be selective
breeding.
Yeah, selective breeding. That's not something that is going to necessarily take place out in the wild, but it is an example of the type of variation that you can get within an animal in a very short period of time.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, I could be wrong on this. I'm not sure they're saying it's not possible. Again, it's kind of like an unnatural setting. And the other thing you could say is the fox is different, but is it a different species? Not necessarily. But again, I think it's kind of like a broad rule. Like, there's some changes that could take millions of years, and there's some changes that might take a lot less. Like I mean, the best example I can give it, if you look at bears, they're all kind of related to each other, right?
Yeah.
But polar bear and like grizzly bear are very closely related, and there's one way of knowing that is they can breed with each other. Most species, even if they're closely related, cannot interbreed. It just won't work. So the fact that they can interbreed is proof that they're pretty closely related, and that was like an environmental thing.
Mm-hmm.
So there's different species that can interbreed, and I think that's one way of saying, but like a brown bear and a black bear, as far as I know, cannot interbreed, but they're pretty similar looking. So they may be like further, you know, branched off a lot further away, so like the way they're built is so much different that it doesn't mesh together.
Could they artificially inseminate and get bear cubs? That's another thing too.
The grizzly and the polar bear?
Yeah, because
actually happened in the wild.
Oh, so they can get a cross. No, I'm talking about the brown bear. What do you say, the brown bear and black bear?
Oh no, brown bear and polar bear have interbred, but I don't believe a black bear and a brown bear can interbreed.
Yeah, so I mean, so there would be some different factors that would come in to because here's the definition of species, which is, if you look into that, it's pretty vague. I mean, you can't really pin it down to one particular thing. And that's where I think a lot of people get confused. They say, well, dogs are an example of evolution. It's like, okay, so is a Chihuahua and a Doberman Pinscher, are they completely different species?
No,
they're not. But look at the morphological differences between a Chihuahua and a Doberman Pinscher. They're pretty drastic. And they can't interbreed. Now, you can artificially inseminate or something like that, and then they can breed. But they because of the body
size
type size differences, they can't. They, it's not. They can't interbreed.
Right.
So, so should they be classified as distinct species because they don't interbreed? And that's you get into a lot of just ill-defined terms and stuff with evolution. You get stuff that. Now, what's interesting to me is these things will be told to children, told everybody else that dogs are examples of evolution. And it's like, okay, so what do you mean by evolution? Do you mean change over time? Because certainly, yeah, they've changed over time. I have gray hair, and I didn't have that when I was younger. That's change over time. Does that mean that's evidence of Darwin's theory? I don't think it is. Now, see, that's what I'm trying to emphasize. They're conflating things that aren't relevant to the particular claim. The particular claim is that one type of animal, for lack of a better word, because like I was talking about, these things are ill-defined, everything is continually progressing to turn into something completely different. Like from a one-celled amoeba to Napoleon Bonaparte, you know that much. So what the evolutionists are contending is that there is no boundaries to evolution. It's just a matter of giving it enough time. Environmental changes. But my contention is that. Well, that is something that has never been observed, and that's where the faith comes in. And it's like, because Darwin didn't discover anything new as far as animals being able to adapt, animals displaying variations within the types of animals, that's something that's been well understood and observed for way before Darwin. So, but his theory is that this explains the origin of species. That's what his book was. It's like this is how everything came to be in biology. And I'll contend that that's fantasy. It's a fairy tale. That's something that's not been observed. If you go in looking for actual evidence for that idea, you're going to come up short because there just really isn't any.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I've never heard anybody say that about dogs, use that as an example. I'm not saying they haven't. It's just never been said to me.
That dogs are an example of evolution?
Right. I've honestly never heard it before. It's the first time I'm hearing it. But I can kind of see where they're going with that. But I've honestly never heard it. But like I said, most people don't consider the dog the same species as a wolf. And I think I could be wrong on this, but most people agree that dogs were once wild animals.
Well, I'll just go off of what
they were.
See, I mean, like, what is a recognized authority as a final word on what evolution is? Because I think a lot of people have a lot of different ideas, and then, you know, it's like, but here's, according to PBS, years of selective breeding by humans has resulted in the artificial evolution of dogs into many different types. Evolution of the dog, behavior change, domestic dogs are different in the form of the wolves mainly. So it does say, hey everybody, here's an example of evolution. It's very common to use dogs as an example of evolution.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I've never heard it before, but I don't necessarily disagree with it either.
Yeah.
I think it is an example. It just depends on like where your major issue comes along. Like, I'm assuming you agree to an extent species can change over time, or no?
That's not even in dispute. Like I said, I have gray hair. I've changed over time.
Well, I mean,
I've gotten taller over time.
Is not age necessarily, but like they could like I said, my example was with the a polar bear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like the colder climate by having white fur.
Yeah, but see that
brown fur.
That begs the question of like, what is the mechanism that permits that? See, I see these animals, you know, out in biology as like they have sort of like a Swiss Army knife of different traits right. that can be called upon when needed. And then, you know, because the way I've heard it explained, described is a genetic code allows for gene expression to be switched on and off. And that's something that's actually been observed to occur.
Right. Well, I guess I'll use that example. Say like a brown bear had a bunch of cubs. Some were white, some were brown. The white ones happened to survive in the colder climate because they can like the predators. I mean, the things they were hunting could not see them.
Mm-hmm.
They were able to like hide better. They were able to eat better. The bears that were more brown could be seen, so they weren't catching anything. The general theory would be that the white bears would be able to be more successful. They would breed more. So hence, over time, all the bears in that region are white. They become a different species. They become a polar bear. That's like an easy example I can give. Like I don't think, you know, to explain every single species that exists on the planet is going to be challenging. I don't think any scientist claims they can do that. But that's like one example.
But like given. See, that's the thing too. A lot of this stuff gets conflated, where it's like, well, if you accept that, then you must by necessity accept that a polar bear, given enough time, can transmogrify into a sea mammal, like a whale or something like that. That's what Darwin initially proposed. By the way, he actually did propose that right. as one potential.
They say whales came from the land.
Wells came, and they still do have a variation of that, even though it's not bears, it's something else, some other mythological creature. I believe was concocted, but it's that's the contention.
You mean an extinct animal?
Well, what are some of the names of Ambliocetus and Pachyocetus and all that stuff, and they contend that they're some kind of predecessor to whales, and they're going to show you some bones with a blowhole on the top of the skull, but then
okay, seriously.
Yeah, stuff like that, and they say, well, that's here's a transitional,
right? So animals that lived on land that eventually became returning to the sea. Yeah, I mean they do have, so that's one connection. I mean it would make sense. It would, if you're going by like what a mammal is, it would kind of make sense that whales were originally living on land. I'm trying to find out exactly where you're at on it. Like I don't know if you're just kind of skeptical of the belief, or you have something in mind that you do believe in, and you're just not sure.
Well, I'll just put it this way: bears will always be bears, dogs will always be dogs, cats will always be cats. Okay. If a Darwinist is going to be consistent in his belief system, you would have to believe that you could take and selectively breed a dog to become something that's indistinguishable from a cat, because there is no boundaries. There is nothing that would prevent right. that, because you're operating off random chance. There is no direction, but you can select for the traits through artificial breeding and artificial selection. And since there is no boundaries, since it's completely haphazard and random, you'll eventually get the traits you want, and then you only select for cat-like traits until you end up with something that's indistinguishable from a cat, if given enough time.
Yeah. Well, it's weird. I have a question for this. You did bring up bears, cats, and dogs, which is interesting because they're all in the same family. You know what I mean? Like they're all like carnivores, not carnivores as in they eat meat. They're in that family called carnivore. Like they're all in that, it's called a group, like phylum group,
right,
species.
Right.
They're all in that group called carnivore, along with raccoons and stuff like that. Like they're basically saying that a dog and a cat are more related than a dog and a chimpanzee. But if you're going to say something is like relate, do you believe that species are like related. You believe like a bear is distantly related to a dog, or there's no relations. Because if you're kind of going to the fact that there's like animals that belong in groups that, you know, they are kind of related to each other, why would they be related to each other if they didn't have similar ancestors at one point in time?
Oh, because
like,
I think
make something related to something else.
I think all of that is just asserted based on evolutionary presuppositions. I don't believe that there is.
So you don't believe in like groups, basically.
No, I mean they're arbitrary in one degree, where it's a lot of this, a lot of the case rests for evolution theory on comparative morphology. So they'll even take a bat wing and say, "Well, look, you got a metatarsal. It's so in a, you know, the metatarsal, what, the bones in the hand. So does the bat. So ergo, there's a relationship there. Therefore, the tree of life." And it's like, that's a logical non sequitur that doesn't necessarily follow. But see, a lot of that, you know, especially with apes, it's like, okay, they got the frontal sight, they have the ears like human beings. Therefore, they must be a common or a close ancestor. And it's all like, well, that's just all, you know, an interpretive bias that's placed on it. My question is, okay, what actual evidence is there of that? And I believe that the actual evidence is because what really at the core, what's being advocated with the evolution theory is that the random mutations have this incredible creative ability or creative power through the process to allow for something like that, and that has never been established. That's something that's just asserted. It's never quantified. It's not explained to you in a quantifiable way, so that you can attach it to actual observed something that's actually observed. It's all, that's where it ventures off into just those stories.
Well, with apes, I actually wanted to bring that up. I've kind of forgot. Just to make it clear to anyone who's listening, or you, the theory of evolution is not that humans evolved from apes. Just want to make that really clear. Whether if you believe in it or not, that's not the theory. The theory is that we had a common ancestor millions of years ago, and apes evolved in their own way, and we've evolved in our own way. You know, we branched off. We didn't, like, literally. So a lot of people, they're very common. I know you didn't say this, but a lot of people will say, well, if evolution is real, why are there still apes? Like, apes evolved, too. Apes are a final product of their lineage, just as we are of us. That is the theory, whether you believe it or not. But I just want to make that clear that people did not come from apes. It wasn't.
It's something akin to an ape, or something even more.
Right. Well, you would have to go down the line, because there's extinct species of humans, like Homo erectus, you know, stuff like that.
But
Homo habilis.
That's the story, you know, and it's an interesting story. I don't think it's much more than a story, though. That's my contention. Is that, like, it's a story. Rudyard Kipling wrote a lot of stories about how, you know, the leopard got its spots, and it's good stories. You know, they're good stories, and they can make sense on a certain level, especially to, you know, children and stuff. And like, I don't have a problem with storytelling, but it's like I just don't go into it as being like, you know, something that's proven or something that's fact, or that something that's stupid if you don't believe in it. It's like, well, I don't know. I do believe that there are some very smart people that believe in these stories, but there's also some very smart people that are, you know, Scientologists. There's also very, very smart people that are Mormons. They're also very, you know, and they're also educated, and they also have, you know, degrees. And, you know, and I believe the same holds true with evolution theory. There's a lot of people that are educated that believe in it. But they're simply stories, and it's like a cult. You know, you kind of enter into this cult, and then everything that you see is sort of evidence of your belief system. And it's like, I believe it's a forced interpretation of observations in the sciences that lead to this idea that this is science, and it's really not.
Well, I will say this. I mean, with people of faith, there's like a vested interest. You would agree, right? Like that they want to be right. They're not really looking for things to disprove their theory or their religion. Like they want to be right. Generally speaking, like I'm only speaking for myself here. Mm. I don't have a vested interest in evolution. Like if there's something that comes along that makes more sense, I'm all for it. Like I really am after the truth. That in my opinion, I really am. I don't have a vested interest. I don't want God to be real. I don't want God to be fake. I don't, or not. You know, I it's like, but I feel people of faith, like they invest so much of their lives in it. They want it to be real, so they're not really looking for. They're not stupid. They're just not looking for things to disprove it necessarily. Yeah, in theory, scientists are supposed to be unbiased. In theory,
right? But there is no actual evidence that the so-called scientific establishment has a sort of immunity from these confirmation biases and stuff that they will point out, and a lot of people that are atheists or Darwinists and stuff they can see it clearly with let's say Mormons or with Christians or Scientologists or somebody like that. They'll say, well, they're biased, they want to believe that, and they claim to have evidence. Like you could go to a Scientologist and say, well, what is this evidence that you have all these so-called thetans running around in your body? And they said, well, we have an e-meter right here. We can hook you up and show you. That's evidence, dude. I mean, they could show you evidence. And it's like, well, I don't accept that. It's like, why? So hypothetically, Josh, if somebody was going to take you and hook you up to an e-meter and show you that you respond a certain way to the galvanic skin response and stuff like that, where they can, demonstrate to you that, you have these thetans in your body, what would make you reject that?
It does come off more as like a fantasy type thing. Like, it's not... Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's a lot wrong with it. I mean, It's not really a matter, the grand scheme of things, saying that God is. I'm never going to debate whether God exists or not, because it's something you can't prove. But something like that to me is kind of ridiculous.
Kind of going more like an epistemology, like what is more? Why is something why is one thing reasonable to believe in and something else is not?
Well, if you're comparing like stuff like evolution to religion, I think there's tons of like fossil evidence of you would agree that there's things that no longer exist, right, that existed at one time.
I've heard,
I'll just say vaguely things.
Yeah, like you could see ammonite fossils that, did you know, right, that like over 90, I don't know the exact figure, but it's 90, it's up in the it's 95 or 90 of all fossils, 95%, 96%, something like that, of all fossils that have ever been found have been trilobites, stuff like that.
I believe it. Heard there's 20,000 species of trilobites, so.
An actual mammalian type or vertebrates is like 0.001% or something like that. It's like
especially with primates. Yeah. I tried looking this up before this, and I couldn't really find why, but I've heard this before, that primates don't, they don't fossilize well. And, I don't know why. So, but I have heard that there's like a giant ape that they found like the jawbone out of teeth of, but that's all they found.
Yeah. And then like you could be shown.
Gigantopithecus.
Right, yeah, and then they'll tell you that, here's, like Lucy, this famous skeleton, and then
I think she's an
Austral.
I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, but.
Yeah, some of those are hard to pronounce.
That's the gist of it.
Yeah, some kind of a Latin terminology put to it. And
that's not even like you know how there's like Homo, like the genus Homo, like Homo sapien, Homo erectus, Homo habilis.
Mm-hmm.
She's not even in that genus. She's like before that.
Yeah. Have you seen the? It was like a PBS documentary, and it's talking about Lucy, and it shows Owen Lovejoy, and he takes the hip bone and he grinds it down on his bench grinder because. Initially, when they found it, it was the hip is curved and it's like it's more like a chimp. But we know right. This is not the case. So they grinded it down, made it kind of flatten it out, and they said, "Oh, see, now it's more human like." And it's like, well, if you can tamper with evidence like that, yeah, you could pretty much make a case for just about anything. So I tend to dismiss that kind of stuff. I don't think that's compelling.
It's not what it is. I mean, I didn't see exactly what you're saying, but it is. I think it is something. I don't think these fossils are like nothing. They're clearly. Do scientists know exactly what they look like? Probably not. But I do believe that they are like extinct species that are no longer here. I mean. If we're disputing that, it's hard for me to really go from there. there's like amateur fossil hunters that find stuff.
Yeah, but would you agree that you have to, just like I was talking about earlier with the e-reader on the Scientologist, don't you have to go into it with a bit of faith in the presenter? In order for them to correctly interpret those fossils for you, because they're not prima facie evidence.
Look like, or how they fit into the evolutionary tree.
Well, yeah, how they support evolution, the Darwin's theory.
Oh, how they support evolution.
Yeah, because that's what we're discussing.
This is the thing. Like, if we're finding species that no longer exist, and we can agree. We might not agree what they look like or what they are, but we agree that this doesn't exist anymore, right? The question is, how are things no longer here and new things are around? Now, if the answer is not evolution, is the answer, do you think it's still up for debate? You're not sure, or do you have an answer?
Oh, why are there so many extinct species?
Is that the question? Things that exist today didn't always exist, right?
Now this is all based on these this presupposition that there's geologic column that's sort of been laid down over millions and millions of years, and then you can go down and dig and then find this layer.
Right.
Then now when you actually get into examining that, dude, I'm telling you, it's actually preposterous. It is completely nonsensical. They'll show you a fossilized fern, for example, and it's like detailed and just pristinely preserved fern leaf. And that's okay. So this got fossilized somehow, obviously. And then, you know, okay, so if you're going to exhume this out of the take it out of the ground, you observing it, and then their contention is, well, this became fossilized over eons, you know, so fossilization takes a long, long time. My question would be, okay, how the hell does that leaf stay so pristine during this whole long, drawn-out process of fossilization? That doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because if you do a cross-section of the strata or wherever it was found in, they say, well, even so much as a quarter of an inch would represent thousands of years. Even if you go down to a width of a human hair, that would be you're still in the thousands of years range, according to the evolutionist presuppositions about the ages of the Earth and everything. So it really gets into some, I mean, really far-fetched shit, man, when you really examine the claims that they're making. And I just don't buy into any of that, man. I don't think fossilization to that leaf took millions or thousands or even hundreds of years to fossilize. There's just no possible way.
Okay, so your issue isn't necessarily with the fossil, it's that your issue is with the age.
my issue is with a lot of different things, but I mean, if we want to kind of steer it back into evolution, I mean, that's the thing about it. I mean, you can go all over the board, paleontology, geology, molecular biology, and all this, so many different aspects to this whole overarching claim of evolution theory. So it's, yeah. It's so you can kind of go off on a tangent any kind of different direction, but right. Let me ask you, like, what do you think is the most compelling evidence for evolution theory that's available today?
Generally speaking, I think it's a lot of factors. Like I said, I was using the example that if animals are related to each other, if we're going to concede that animals, if we're going to concede a tiger is related to a lion, and I think you don't have to know a whole lot about those things mm-hmm. to see that they're somewhat similar, right? And again, they can also interbreed. So, yeah. Again, that's another red flag. I think if things are related to each other, it only makes sense that they came from a common ancestor. Why, if nothing was coming from common ancestors, why would anything look like anything? It would just be just a huge coincidence. I mean, like, something like a marsupial, which is like a huge group of animals that don't even look anything alike, but they have that common thing. They have, like, the baby that is born that's very, like, cannot move on its own barely, and it goes inside a pouch, and it kind of develops in the pouch. But a koala looks nothing like a kangaroo. So, and there's like wombats and, you know, Tasmanian yeah. tigers. These are all things that have that feature. Like, why do they have that feature? Now, the simple answer, the counter answer to that, a lot of people just say, well, you know, it's just God's way. God made them that way. I don't think that's your answer. I don't know you enough, but I don't think that's your answer.
I think the best explanation is a creationist point of view. Somehow, I believe in God, and I believe God created life on the planet. Yeah, I don't, okay. I believe that's what the evidence best supports that. Back to what evolution is claiming that all this stuff can be accounted for through some random process, and it's like, nah, that's not even viable at all.
You don't think it's possible that some people, I'm not saying I believe this, but some people believe that God created evolution, like he willed it.
No, then the question is, what do you mean by evolution? The ability for
species to change, right?
No, I think that's
basically.
Well, like I stated earlier, I'm not even contending that animals have ability to adapt or change. I think that's
right.
been
Depends
observed.
The limit to it, though.
That's been observed before Darwin. You know, domesticated animals. You could.
Right.
I mean, just take. Like a domesticated turkey, you know, it's like, compare it to a wild turkey.
Right.
There's this vast difference. Well, they're the same type of animal, but they've been selectively bred for specific traits, and they won't fare well in the wild. I'm pretty sure of that. But that doesn't prove Darwin. It doesn't even. It's not. I mean, that, like I said, that was observed way before Darwin came along. Now, he's content, like, the Darwin theory is saying, well, you can keep breeding a turkey and you can breed it into an entirely different animal given enough time, because these adaptive changes are cumulative. They'll build up, and that there's just no evidence for that, man. That's what I'm saying.
I mean, I wouldn't say that. I guess it just depends on, like, what you believe. Like, if you're not – there's, like, multiple steps to, like, believing in evolution. And if you're not believing in the fossil evidence, that kind of, like, pits kind of, you know, kind of like a halt to the whole thing. Because, like, you're already kind of contending that there's something fishy about the fossil evidence. So if you're contending there's something fishy about the fossil evidence,
like what,
right,
like,
off the bat.
Specifically what fossil?
Well, you're basically – like, this fossils of all, you know, animals that, like, say, like, a saber-toothed cat, which would be, like, a predecessor to our living cats of today.
Uh-huh.
But like I said, it depends. Like if you're not believing that that thing existed, or you're believing something fishy about that, then it's very easy to dismiss the whole thing, because a lot of evolution isn't really about, well, look at this turtle, it changed into a bird. It's more about things that have come and gone, and you know, that's where we're like, say you go back to the Ice Age, or like the Triassic or the Dryas. Those are all like animals that would eventually be like a modern version of those, like extinct giant rhinos and woolly rhinos, like all these. So it depends, like if you're kind of discounting that's a huge part of it. So it's kind of it's more of like how it's hard to like for me to really like go on with it more. Like say like a woolly mammoth. You think there's pretty sufficient evidence that those existed?
I don't have a problem with woolly mammoth or saber-toothed tigers or anything like that.
Yeah, well, I'm saying
so they're a variation on a bodies. They're a variation of a kind of animal.
The same, yeah.
It'd be like,
yeah.
Okay, so what if people stop breeding chihuahuas? Does that mean Darwin was right? It's like, nope. Say chihuahuas go extinct because nobody breeds them anymore and they just go extinct. Does that mean Darwin was right? No. It's like Darwin's never, nothing that we've said so far even establishes Darwin in no way, shape, or form. I mean, changes observed in animals or adaptations don't prove Darwin, because it would be a law right now instead of a theory. So that's not proof of Darwin. You got to get specific about exactly what are you claiming.
I think with evolution, I think it's always going to be kind of one of those things where it's always going to be considered a theory, no matter how much evidence or maybe lack therefore evidence there is, because it's not something that really matters. And by that, I mean it's not like climate change where people can debate about that. But like whether climate change is real or not, it kind of matters, because we have to do something about it if it is real, right? But with evolution, if evolution isn't true, it's not like it's really affecting anybody. Or if it is true, it's not affecting anybody either. It's just kind of a thing. And if you're not really interested in it, it doesn't affect your daily life. Or global warming would, right?
Well, it does have some... I think ideas matter, and I think that they have philosophical implications that impact.
Say, like, your average Joe just goes to work, doesn't give a fuck about anything.
Yeah.
It might not matter to him.
Well, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But that doesn't have any bearing on whether it's scientific or true or not.
Oh, no, it doesn't. What I'm saying is that it's just never something that's going to be – let's hypothetically say it's true, right? Just hypothetically. Mm-hmm. It's not something – that people are going to be like, you have to believe in this, because if not, we're all screwed, you know, because it doesn't matter if people don't believe in it or not. It doesn't really have any real world like bearings on us. So that's why I know you were saying that's why it's not considered law. It's considered theory. Like I said, I'm not really here to convince anything. I'm just really here to express what I think. So I do think it's pretty much proven. But at the same time, I'm willing to entertain other ideas, because otherwise, what's the point of having a discussion?
Yeah.
But at the same time, I don't think it's ever going to be like, this is definitely true, because it doesn't have like a bearing on everyday life.
I would disagree with that. I think it has a direct bearing on people's attitudes toward life, towards their relationship to other people, their relationship to perceived authority. It's got some very profound philosophical implications, and there's no doubt about it. I don't think there's any doubt about that. It's a definitely demonstrably political. We just had this Dover trial thing with now, if it's not political, how the hell does a judge have the final word on what science is, Josh? That doesn't make any damn sense. This is obviously political. It's obviously political posturing going on, and to have the sort of monopoly on a worldview is very powerful. It's very influential, and it's no doubt political, and it's no doubt influential, and it no doubt has a lot of persuasive power on selling certain other ideas as well. It's sort of an underpinning for some other ideas that are right. being pushed. And I think that one thing, too, to be observed about it is that it's sort of a philosophy that favors sort of these artificial hierarchies that are put in place right now. It's like, well, survival of the fittest. Well, why are they the fittest? Because they're the ones ruling. They're the ones with the most money. They're the ones at the top. So they're the fittest. So therefore, they're basically like God on earth. They're the highest form of the highest form. And if they want to take now and direct evolution, because it's an unguided random process, and now there's plenty of documentation to back this up. I'm not making this up. That they're contending, they say something that we should do is we should guide and direct evolution. We should do things like maybe eradicate all the differentiation among individuals and make everyone into, you know, make the common man into sort of like this hermaphrodite, no specific race that can be identified and all this stuff. There's a lot of people that are contending for this, and it's like, okay, if we evolved and it's a random process, well, why not let the fittest among us decide where evolution is going to go? That's where I'm talking about this philosophical implications of this idea. So, yeah, it's very important that this idea is challenged, and I challenge it on the basis that there is just no evidence for it, and there, it has not been established. There's evidence piling up that the mechanism that is proposed for it is totally inadequate. It doesn't explain anything in biology. The only thing they have to prop it up is these just so stories. They used to say that your appendix was a proof of a vestigial organ as a holdover from your ancient past, and that's just not true. Turns out that it has a pretty vital role in building your immunity and building up your gut flora and everything. So it's a dangerous idea too. It has direct impact. So if you go around and you've had your spleen taken out, or if you had your tonsils taken out, stuff like that, you're going to have problems for the rest of your life. And that was all done through a motivation of this Darwinist evolutionist presupposition. They also believe that 98% of DNA has no function. That favors an evolutionary interpretation. Now they're finding out that that's not true, and they're finding out that, well, this evolutionary presupposition has probably set back genetic science for pretty significantly. Because it was always just so how does it advance science if you can just chalk something up to being a product of random chance that doesn't have any function? But see, they're claiming the opposite, that belief in God and belief that everything is designed and has a purpose is harmful to science. But you can't show any, you can't demonstrate that. But see, I can show examples of where evolution theory has obviously hindered science and investigations into scientific inquiry based on these evolutionary presuppositions. So, yeah, it does matter that the people believe in this or not.
I agree it matters too, but I'm probably going in a little bit of an opposite direction. But just to clarify, this is not saying that you believe it in any way, shape, or form, but you literally think there's zero evidence towards evolution, like nothing that could be sort of pointing at it.
Common descent and random mutation and natural selection having any kind of creative power. Yeah, I don't know. Those things that I just mentioned,
so you're saying it's like, there's like something
evidence
that you could sort of. But what I'm saying is, like, you think there's something out there that can kind of be in favor of it, or you think there's literally zero evidence? Like, literally zero.
Of common descent? No, there's no evidence.
Of evidence of evolution in general. Like, is there something you can viably say that, okay, that kind of makes sense? Like, or you think there's nothing out there?
Well, if evolution, you mean common descent. As a no, I don't. There's no evidence for that.
That one animal evolves from another.
No, that one, yeah, one kind of animal is a predecessor to another animal.
Right.
Different kind of animal.
Right, so you're not saying a different type of feline or a different type of canid. You're saying a turtle from a snake.
Or a turtle, like, into a dog.
Something
it's
that
not happening.
Right, so something, well, that wouldn't happen because it's reptiles and mammals are just again,
but they have a common ancestor. So whatever. So what? Do. So tell me, what was the common ancestor between a turtle and a dog?
Well, there was something called like the Metrodon.
Yeah.
Which was like a proto mammal. I'm not saying that that is the missing link. I'm not saying that.
But you don't know. That, you don't know.
No. I'm saying that it's something that, that is like kind of like not quite a mammal, but wasn't a reptile either.
And so you have that. You have evidence of that having that, existed.
That the Metrodon existed, or that it wasn't a reptile.
Or that it was demonstrably an in-between state between mammals and reptiles.
I don't think it actually. I think what they're saying is that it didn't directly evolve, but it's an example of like an evolutionary like.
Okay, so you don't know. I mean, you really don't have any idea.
Well, like I said, I'm not trying to like cheat. I don't have the internet by me. I read a lot of stuff. Some of it goes in and out. You know, there's a lot
but
of
you,
names.
But you believe it's there. You believe Metrodon existed, and that's that was where they split off.
Definitely exists.
44.4 million years ago, or something like that, maybe.
It existed before the dinosaurs, and this is
okay. Six,
when I'm saying
75 million.
Keep in mind, I'm not saying them to debate. I'm saying them as what that's what is out there.
Yeah, you'll hear a lot of people. Speak like that. They'll say, well, see, now you need to go back 75 million years. It's like, you're going back millions of years and billions of years, stuff like that. That's an extraordinary claim, for one thing, that you can have any bearing or any idea of what transpired 75 million years ago. Wild claim. That's really far out there.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, it's science. Science is constantly evolving. Like when we first discovered dinosaurs, we didn't think of them as we think of them now. Like it's science isn't the answers just aren't given to us. They do research. They discover new things. Scientists are wrong all the time.
Yeah, but on the other hand, you have this dogma that's undeniable. Where you, especially you get on the internet, you start going around. It's like, oh, you idiot! You don't believe in evolution. It's like. Well, give me some reason to believe in it. And they can't explain it or can't tell you in their own words. They're going to refer you to go get a degree. That's idiotic.
Yeah, well,
what's the point?
To explain it. I'm not telling you to go read about it.
I've had people. You should watch that that video on my YouTube channel, Atheist Experience. Logical fallacies are our bread and butter. I called in and I talked to that Matt Dillahaney guy, and I was just pointing out that he's a believer in evolution. He states that it's a fact, and I'm just pointing out that it's like, well, everything that he gives as evidence for this evolution theory is. You can go and look up a list of logical fallacies and see where, okay, so he made appeals to authority. He made an unsubstantiated claim based on something that, you know, this third party investigated and saying, well, that's proof of evolution. He was specifically talking about the supposed chromosome 2 in humans that are supposedly establishes a link between the common ancestor between humans and apes that Ken Miller is that's attributed to him. He referred me to that because I was asking, okay, what's empirical, what can you observe directly that's, you know, evidence of evolution. So it's like that's not empirical. Referring me to a paper is not empirical. That's just not. I could still accept that Ken Miller did some observations probably. But see now, are his interpretations, are those correct? That's what's in contention here. And it's like, I break that down logically. You know, if he's making a claim based on his observations, right. Like how does he substantiate this claim? But see, you know, you get all these different variant claims that supposedly back up this theory. When you go to explore them or examine them, they break down because they don't hold up under scrutiny or under logic. That's been my experience. But
you would contend that a chimpanzee, somewhat similar to a human, on a very simple level, on like a visual level, you would say a chimpanzee.
Yeah, superficially there is similarities.
Right.
But then if that establishes Darwin, then it's case closed. See, the comparative morphology is what you're always going to be referred to. And it's like, well, if that establishes Darwin, then it's case closed. But see, that was already observed well before him, like I said. His claim is distinct in that Darwin is claiming that this is evidence of common descent. And that's the thing that's being contended. Not that animals adapt, not that there's morphological similarities between different types of animals.
The general consensus is like something like a monkey is further away from a human, and there's like a lemur is further away from a human. Not even going into like the DNA and the chromosomes and you know all that sciencey stuff. Just by visual things, you can say, well, a monkey kind of looks like a person, but not as much as a chimp. And I know you do say that those observations were made way before Darwin, but I'm actually curious to know, when did the civilized world know about apes? Because something like a gorilla was actually like part of cryptozoology at one point. People didn't believe in gorillas till someone actually found one, and I believe it was like early 1900s. I could be wrong on that.
Was that right? I didn't know that.
Yeah, people who lived in Africa, but like to talk about like Europe, like the scientific community, they actually didn't know gorillas existed till somebody actually had to capture one and bring it to. Now, I don't know about chimps, though. I don't know if they were aware of chimps before gorillas.
Oh, I'm sure, because the British, you know, they've been all up in India. You know, monkeys are crawling all over the place in India, so they had to know about.
So we're talking about specifically monkeys, not chimpanzees.
Maybe not. Chimpanzees, I don't know about chimps.
Only in Africa. And they're also I know it's a thin line to some people, but there is a distinct difference between an ape and a monkey.
Yeah, but to see, I mean, so...
Like a New World monkey and an Old World monkey are actually supposedly very different.
Yeah.
A New World monkey meaning something that lives... A monkey lives in South America. They have the tails that can, like, use as a fifth appendage where the Old World monkeys can't.
Yeah. Well, comparative...
There's little things here and there.
Comparative morphology. You ever heard of the sheep's head fish?
Sheep's head fish? Sounds vaguely familiar.
So it has...
know a lot about fish.
It has teeth that look an awful lot like human teeth.
Okay.
I mean,
something from Paku.
Yeah, so it's pretty crazy looking. Like, you look at, they open their mouth, these fish, and they got teeth, like human teeth.
Yeah.
But they have rows of teeth, but, the similarities are very striking. And I don't hear anybody making a case that that's a direct descendant of humans. But see, you have
something like a coelacanth. You heard of
coelacanth is they found those alive, you know, but that was there's an example of that science declared it extinct. So there's an example for you of something that is definitely not extinct because they catch them alive today.
Yes.
And and then there's another thing too about this claim of extinct species, you know, because that's going to paint a picture of, you know, millions and millions of years of evolution. And then there's like, oh, we could go dig up all these extinct species from the past showing that everything is going extinct. And then it's like, well, then there's also the flip side of that where only 15% of all species on the earth have yet been discovered. So we still have like 85% of all species yet to discover on the planet. So those are in contrast, I believe. So then again, too, it begs the question, and then you have to define what actually is a species.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's – the thing is that with science, there's exceptions to the rules. I think you could describe a species, but it's not like – for the most part, different species can't interbreed, but some species can interbreed. So, like I said, there's exceptions. That's the thing. Like, I think what you're saying is that you're kind of being suspicious of how many things were extinct.
When they say what is the claim? I mean, it's that there's
like 99% of everything is gone extinct.
Has gone extinct.
It's never
But
never
what does that even mean, though? It's like, is that so? You can go back and you can according to science, you can dig up a crocodile that's 150 million years old.
Okay.
You could put it side by side with a crocodile living today, and I defy you to tell me the difference. Now, is that an extinct species of crocodile that they're claiming is another example of an extinct species? Because this particular crocodile had two nodules behind its eyes, and so therefore it's a different species.
Well,
so therefore it counts as the part of the 95%.
Hmm.
See, that's where all of this breaks down. You start to examine it, and the logical glue that holds the theory together disintegrates.
Well, Sarcosuchus is a, and forgive me if I'm pronouncing it wrong, is a extinct species of crocodile, and it was far larger than anything that exists today.
But do we? How big was it?
Around, I believe it was around 50 feet long.
No, I saw a crocodile at the Singapore Zoo, and they said that sucker was almost 30 feet, and that. It was freaking unbelievable. I had no clue that a crocodile's got that big. Or is that an alligator crocodile? It was like a... So...
It's probably a saltwater crocodile, which is generally the largest species.
Yeah. So is it another example of a coelacanth, or maybe there is 50-foot crocodiles possibly somewhere, maybe in Africa or somewhere?
I mean, a species that large, and I could be off on the length. It could be even bigger. It's at least 50. Like I said, I'm not trying to, like, quote unquote, I don't know. I'm not trying to quote unquote cheat by looking shit up. I'm trying to go off, you know, things I remember. It could be even larger than that.
But that would be an example of an extinct species. So it's like, but
right,
it's still a crocodile. It's not something that's completely distinct from everything that we know.
Crocodilian.
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah, it's like that doesn't really – I don't see how it supports Darwin. I really don't.
Well, you don't see how an extinct primitive form of something would give birth to a more of a modern version or a different version.
Yeah, but when you say primitive form, that presupposes the thing that you're trying to argue for.
Primitive probably wasn't the right word to use. A different version, because primitive doesn't necessarily mean it was like less equipped or not as strong, or it was less equipped for the environment possibly. The coelacanth living today is not the same coelacanth they're finding fossil of. It's similar where they're calling it a coelacanth, but it's still a different version.
Yeah, it just looks practically indistinguishable. Now, I'm sure they can go into some scientific technicals and tell you how it's not the same thing, but by all appearances, it would be, for appearance sake, trivial. So to build some kind of strong case based on something like that, I just see, yeah, that's where I'm saying that the evidence sort of is very paper thin, wafer tissue thin fabric.
What about something
we're
talking like about? A sauropod, the long necked dinosaurs? There's nothing like that that lives today. And I was actually reading a book that actually made a point. This isn't necessarily proving my point at all, but I'll say it anyway. They were saying that they found there's like supposedly there's tons of species of sauropods. If you look this up, there's like 20, 30 species of sauropods just in South America alone. And they were saying that it doesn't make sense that so many species of gigantic animals would live side by side, because that doesn't really happen. You know, they were like 10 times bigger than elephants, and there's really only elephants. So how can an environment support? So they were saying that they're not really sure where these species fit in. Are they 30 different species? Are they variations of four species? So that's why I kind of can see what you're saying. But that's the thing. You have to contend, like, something like – that's the thing. Do you believe that something like sauropods existed, or you think there's still evidence up for grabs on that?
I don't know that they don't exist now. I mean, there's another presupposition that says they say – I've read this. I could pull up the article probably if you wanted me to. It's like that we have still yet to discover most of the species on the planet.
Right.
As far as science goes. So it's like, to make like any really strong claim based on you know, whether a species exists or not. Like, is it, like, so coelacanth, when they found one of those alive, did it upturn, right. did it upturn evolution theory? No, of course not. See, it's unfalsifiable, too. That's another thing about evolution theory, is it cannot be falsified, so therefore it's really not, it doesn't even operate as a scientific theory, because in order for it to operate as a scientific theory, it has to be falsifiable. It's not falsifiable.
So you're saying that there's really nothing that, kind of like what I was saying about God, there's really nothing that you could discover that would necessarily disprove it.
That's
what you're saying, right?
Yeah, I mean, what would you say would disprove evolution?
What would disprove evolution? I know what you're saying. I completely understand what you're saying. And I think conversations like this are important, because even if somebody doesn't believe in anything you're saying, it will make them work harder. It will make them try to find the answers. And I think that's good. Or maybe, you know, coming from my point of view, I think it's good, because it makes people try to find these answers. That's a really good question, that what would be a discovery that would find it. You know, you might have a point there, that they're probably really, wouldn't it be like a smoking gun, per se, that would disprove it?
Well, yeah, any viable theory
it could be disproven, right.
What it is based on, yeah. There was a famous scientist pointed that out. It's just sort of something that's generally accepted in science, that any scientific theory that's proposed, it has to be falsifiable. There's got to be some possibility of it being proved wrong, or else it's not a workable theory.
In a way, it's similar to God, because you really can't prove that God doesn't exist.
I've heard people say, there's a teacup orbiting Jupiter. You know, like, what? How do you falsify that?
Right,
you have to go there. You say anything.
You can say there's a
So what would falsify evolution?
You know, you know what? If something comes to me, I will definitely bring it up. But right now, I'm tending to agree with you that there really isn't anything that I can think of that would necessarily falsify. I don't think that necessarily makes it any less valid. Like, that alone doesn't make it less valid, per se. But I do agree that you would have a hard time finding something. I mean, unless anything short of God opening up the clouds and saying, I'm God, I made everything, you know, other than that, I don't really have a good answer for you. I'll be honest. I tend to agree. There wouldn't be a smoking gun.
Yeah, I had to look that up. It's actually attributed to Karl Popper, Basic Scientific Principles.
I never thought of that. I'll give you that.
Falsifiability, let me give you the definition real quick so I don't misrepresent it. It's defined as, by the philosopher Karl Popper, defines the inherent testability of any scientific hypothesis. Science and philosophy have always worked together to try to uncover truths about the world and the universe, blah, blah, blah. Let's see. It's trying to get down to what... Yeah, basically, it's that was pretty much accurate. It has to be, you're making your hypothesis. It has to be make predictions, which evolutionists claim that the theory of evolution has this great explanatory power. And they'll point out that, like, we know that viruses change and, adapt. So we wouldn't be able to make vaccines, and we'd be screwed if we didn't know about evolution theory. It's like, okay, now how is that? Now, you have this observation that viruses adapt or change. How does that have any bearing on whether evolution is true or not? And how is having an understanding of evolution that things do change when you can directly observe them changing? That doesn't – you see what I'm saying? And that will always be held out as an example where the evolution theory had this predictive power that was greatly beneficial in moving medical science forward. And it's like, that's not logical, dude. Like, you can make an observation. That observation stands on its own. You can make the observation that these viruses adapt. How does that – maybe you can explain to me how believing Darwin has any impact on that observation.
I don't think it necessarily does. I don't think
it wouldn't. No, obviously not.
I don't,
But why is that? If there's all this evidence for evolution and its validity and its value in the sciences, why do they point shit like that out all the time? Or sickle cell anemia as a and as example of beneficial mutation. it's ridiculous, dude.
Well, I think there are some people that don't believe even in that. I think there's some people that don't believe. Like, I don't know. I don't think there's some people that believe that species can change at all. So I think
if there's, dude, if there's evidence for it, then you don't have to make a case based on sickle cell anemia. That's to make a case based on sickle cell anemia is demonstrable of the fact that they don't have anything else. They don't have any beneficial mutations, which is the whole theory rests on beneficial mutations, because beneficial mutations is what drives species forward, is what is responsible for all the variability and the diversity of life on the planet. That is the Darwinist contention. And if they have to go to sickle cell anemia to show an example of that, dude, how bankrupt is the theory? Now, and that's evidence that this is faith-based, and they just want to latch on to any thin straw that they can to point and to substantiate their theory. And there's just countless examples of this, man, where it's just like they want so strongly want to believe, because it's a cult. This and the general populace in general, they don't look at it this way because they were conditioned and brought up through the public school system and everything to defer to this authority that's backed up by, you know, everything you see around you and you're exposed to as a child growing up. And then it, you know, as you become an adult, you get exposed to this scientific council that's allegedly out there, and they believe in this idea. And it's like, here's one thing that I would like anybody listening to this and you too, Josh, to take away from this is like, challenge the premise of it. Just in the fundamental premise is like, evolutionary theory rests on this one idea, is that there's a bunch of smart people that are scientists that believe in it. Challenge the premise, challenge that premise, and then you really don't have anything to base evolution theory on if you remove the foundational premise of that perceived authority. You'll have to establish that they're immune from biases and groupthink and all the other things that beset every other human institution. And that's what I'd like to challenge anybody that believes in evolution. I'd like to challenge them on that one point.
Right, but I think that the evidence they're using, like I said, is fossilized animals that had similar features.
Mm-hmm.
And so
the living animals have similar features.
They do, but yeah. A lion didn't. Again, I'm going with the theory. I'm going with what the general theory is. A lion didn't evolve into a tiger. Stuff that's alive today didn't evolve into each other. They're more or less, with some exceptions. The bear is kind of an exception to that. For the most part, like, things slowly evolve from things that no longer existed. And some, and just to go back to the thing of sauropods, it's a giant 100-foot animal existing is a little far-fetched as opposed to a coelacanth, which lives very, very deep in the ocean. That's something that could kind of, like, be missed. I know you brought up that a lot of species haven't been found yet, but most of those are, like, pretty much insects and, like, kind of like different types of mice and very small animals. Like, to find a new large animal is very rare.
Well, like we just got through agreeing on, that the overwhelming majority of all fossils ever collected are invertebrates, sea animals,
right,
trilobites, right. Ammonites, that sort of thing.
The thing could be that the conditions for them were just better. Like, there's the tar pits in California where there's like dire wolves and saber-toothed cats. That was a good environment for those animals to be found. Mm-hmm. It's possible fossilization is a rare occurrence. To find like an entire dinosaur skeleton isn't like, it's extremely, extremely rare. Trilobites lived for like they were around a very long time, and they were probably very numerous. Like, think of ants compared to like an elephant. How many more ants are there than elephants? So just by that, we're gonna have more examples of that type of fossil. But like I said, it depends on like where your problem starts. Do you have a problem with how old the Earth is? Do you have a problem with do you accept that certain species are, like, do you believe it something can be extinct? Like, obviously, you believe in that, correct?
Oh, a particular type of animal being extinct.
The species could be extinct.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I don't see right. how that makes a case for Darwinism.
No, it doesn't. But like I said, it all leads. It all kind of. There's not one particular thing that proves evolution. It's many things, if it's true at all. It's not.
Like I said earlier, there's also evolutionary marketing, which they say that's it's backed up by Darwinism. That your evolutionary past and makeup has an impact on what kind of floor wax you'll buy. Stuff like that. Is that evidence? I don't think so. There's tons of claims, dude. I'm not denying that. There's thousands upon thousands, and it's wide and varied, and in the modern mind, Darwin is sort of like the god of science, you know, and he's referred to that way. People say that the evolution is the greatest idea ever, you know. Here's the thing. It's a fairy tale. It's a fairy tale for adults. And there actually is no evidence of this thing having any real explanatory power. Right. That's what I would contend.
So when you say fairy tale, you're closed off to the idea. You don't really want evidence. You kind of decided that it's not true.
Oh, I know that there's, like I just got through stating, like, you know, there's claims, there's observations. Like, what is science? Like, you're making some observations out there in the world, right? That we got to define what science is.
Sure.
So
but what I'm
So supposedly this idea, this theory has been backed up by this thing called science, which would imply direct observations out there in the actual physical world. That's the claim.
Well, like I said, it goes by like similarities, and I guess you can again chalk it up to God, if that's what you choose, if that's what you want to do. But there's no doubt that there's families of animals with animals that are similar, and they get less and less similar as the family tree goes down the line. Like a gorilla and chimp have a lot in common. And compared to a spider monkey, a little bit, but not so much. And then compared to a rhinoceros, even less. But they're both mammals. Then you go to like the different groups of, you know, well, a reptile is this, but it's also a vertebrate. So a lizard and a rhino have less in common, but they still have some in common. Then you're going with a beetle, which is an animal, but it's also an invertebrate. So they have even less in common. So even if you don't think it's true, it does kind of make sense how things would spawn off from each other. You know what I'm saying? Because like, as they're branching off in the tree, they're going to become less and less alike. So even if you think it's a quote unquote fairy tale, there is something to say for that, that, you know, that these things have something in common, and that would make sense that they would be from each other, even if they aren't.
Right. But then have you heard, you know what convergent evolution is?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but is it when something evolves kind of similarly, but like from like kind of like a coincidence?
Right. Or, so like they're not
like
related.
Like a sloth and a monkey.
They're not related by any depiction of the so-called tree. They're unrelated. They're separate branches. They're unrelated species, yet they have the same morphology. They have even the same... gene sequencing, but they evolve separately at different instances. So like one example would be, I called Ken Miller up at his university, and I just asked him a couple of questions because it was related to chromosome 2. So he's saying that it's the gene is the same, so he's used the word synteny. It has the same genetic sequencing, and you could see that with the chromosome 2. And then I just asked him, like, you know, so there's a lot of this genetic synteny between the DNA of apes and humans. And he said, oh yeah, so it's like, so that establishes the lineage. And So, well, yeah, you know, it's like, well, what in, and then I asked him, I said, what in the case of like the, you know, bioluminescence in different species of squid, unrelated species of squid, where you have the same genetic syntony and everything like that, and then the conclusion is the opposite, where they're not related. So you have a logical disconnect. You can make a claim based on a set of observations that establish lineage. You could take the same observations in these unrelated species and then come to the conclusion that they're not related. So that's so in the case of
something with bioluminescence, I think an example to give a good example would be something like a squid that might have it and then a fish that might have it. One's an invertebrate, one's a vertebrate.
Well, there's this particular peer-reviewed paper that I was referring to. It was dealing with bioluminescence in squid, unrelated species of squid that is held up as an example of convergent evolution.
I find that odd that they would say unrelated species of squid, because even if the species aren't closely related, they had to have been related at some point because they're both squid. So they're somewhat related.
Yeah, but the bioluminescence is not common throughout the squid kingdom, you know. So,
a lot of deep sea animals have been, but I think a better example would be, I know the paper you read was comparing two species of squid, but what I feel a better comparison, if I was going to argue your case, would be a squid and a fish that had bioluminescence, because a fish is millions and millions and millions and millions of years evolved from a squid, which is a mollusk and also an invertebrate. So they're not even on the same, you know, according to evolution, a fish is more related to a human than it is a squid.
Well, I mean, the end result is the same, where according to the claim, it's convergent evolution. In other words, the syntony, the genetic similarity, the sequence specificity that's across the board on both species is not evolutionary significant in that it establishes a relationship. So so the conclusion is that they evolve separately and just through happenstance happen to have the same sequencing. That's the evolution. Right, that's their position. So
something very specific.
What's that again?
I was going more broad, like mammals have hair, they give birth to live young, reptiles lay eggs. That's, I was going more of like a broad sense. What you're
right,
saying
but
is
you
still
could,
a valid point.
What I'm pointing out here is what I'm trying to get to is that you can make a case for, with evolution theory, you can make a case to establish a lineage, and then you can make a case to establish the opposite. It's the theory is so incredibly flexible, dude, that it you can, if you find something, you can use evolutionary to explain it, and then you could find its opposite, and evolutionary explains that. So it explains everything and its opposite with equal fluidity. It's so fluid, so malleable.
Disagreeing that there is.
I think that's a pretty good example of that, what I just pointed out.
Oh,
and
no,
that's peer-reviewed paper I'm referring to. I'm not just making shit up out of my head or referring to
this
creationist
thing,
literature
though,
or anything like that.
I'm speaking for myself here. Scientists don't have it all figured out. There's some mystery left in the world. Now, to say it's a coincidence, I guess someone of faith could say, well, God made them be able to see at night at a dark depth because they can't see. I don't know if that's where you're going.
I don't
with
really
it.
Think that you can make the point that the so-called scientific community is not quite dogmatic on evolution having happened. I mean, I just brought up the Dover trial where it's like, oh, you can't teach anything other than Darwinism because anything other than Darwinism is not science. This is essentially what the end result was. And all everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people that are regarded as, you know, pro-science, they're all celebrating, oh, that's a great outcome of that trial. And it's like, so you really can't. You can't reconcile that with the position that, oh, scientists don't know everything and everything is still open to question. And sure, we welcome questions, and that is, no, they don't, dude. They absolutely do not. And that's That's obviously not the case.
I can't speak for them, but I might.
In science, it's settled. Darwin was right. It's just a matter of sorting out the details as far as they're concerned. Mm-hmm. If you take anything that's out there that's presented, that's definitely what you're going to take away from that, is that's the position that it's like, it's pretty much set in stone. It's pretty much settled. There's might be some minor quibbling among some of the specifics, but Darwin was right, and he's being vindicated every day with every new discovery. And that's just not even true, man. That's just not true. And now the cult is still there, and the belief system is still entrenched. When I asked specifics to Ken Miller, he had to go to class immediately. He couldn't answer my question. And it's like, well, it's a very simple, direct question. It should take like 2 minutes to answer. You know,
I think that's the problem, is that if an actual scientist can't answer these questions, I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to.
Well, that's the issue too. It's that, normally what you'll get is like, Chris, you need to talk to a biologist. And I just give you an example. I got their call recorded. It's posted up if you want to go check it out. It's at hoaxbusterscall.com. You could put in Google Hoaxbusters Call Ken Miller, and it'll probably take you straight to it. But it's an example where, okay, so I did what was required of me. And it's kind of sort of a follow-up to the conversation I had with Matt Dillon-Huntney, he's pretty well known in atheist circles. He's been on panels with Richard Dawkins and all that. So he's
right.
So the reason why I'm bringing that up is like the guy should know his stuff. You know what I mean? If he's making a claim and he believes in evolution theory, he should be able to back it up. And with that said,
don't you think there still could hypothetically, can evolution be true and not everything be exactly sorted out?
Well, that's a good point, because you could have something that's true, and then you could have it just so happens that the people I've spoken with just don't have good arguments. That doesn't mean it's false.
Right.
That just means maybe not many people have a good argument for it. But that doesn't mean it's true either. And my contention is that it's just not true. And I have yet to like get any real coherent kind of explanation of exactly what establishes this claim, this random mutation giving rise to all the diversity of life claim, which is what I'm contending. I'm not arguing that animals don't adapt. Darwin's finches, I believe that's a correct observation, that the beaks have adapted to suit the different environments and the different seeds. I believe that's something that's common in nature. There's a lot of examples of that type of thing. But here's the thing, Josh. It's like they turn back. It's the beak and the morphology and the beaks adapts and changes to environmental conditions of drought and stuff like that. And that's what they've observed subsequent to Darwin. And it's like, that's not Darwin's theory. The observation is that it's cyclical and it responds rapidly to environmental stressors, not gradual, slight incremental changes over vast aeons of time, which Darwin necessitates.
Again, I will say this. When Darwin made his discoveries, when he was alive, we didn't really have a true concept of dinosaurs. We now know a lot of, especially the predatory ones, had feathers. We didn't know that during his time. So it is safe to say that he might not be necessarily 100% on the money with everything. That's sort of
basic though. His basic fundamental
that evolution takes
premise based on his observation of finches. But if you look at what
I think it could,
and I'm referring to peer reviewed papers, by the way, on this. I'm not making this up either. You can go pull this stuff up about Darwin's finches, rapid morphological changes observed in the beaks, and then them returning back to the previous state and going to more of the general population having the similar beak types as the environmental conditions change over relatively relatively speaking, nanoseconds in time on certainly an evolutionary scale.
In the grand scheme of things, yeah.
Yeah.
Uh, Yeah, exactly. Like I said, I think he means like more, like more of like a drastic change, not little minor. That's like a minor change. It's not a, that's not species of species. It's well, just it, one little thing.
Well, like I said, it's like where they have like this. I think a pretty good analogy is like Swiss Army knife kit of different traits that the organism can kick in, so to speak, and turn back off, so to speak. At will, at when they're needed, and when they're not needed, they recede back and they go back to their previous state, stuff like that. That stuff's been observed. If the mechanism that's being proposed is random mutations and natural selecting acting on those random mutations, that doesn't suit the observation.
I think it's more something where a change would occur, where a species would be turned from one species to another, but they're still similar enough, but they're now two different species, and at that point they wouldn't be able to go back. We've never observed that in modern times, though. There's no new species where we can say this didn't. I think there are, you know what, I shouldn't say that. I think there is an insect where there is, but I don't want to use that because I don't have the information in front of me. But I think there is like a new insect that didn't necessarily exist, but it was in a cave or something. But unfortunately, I don't have that information. But to say we never said, oh, look at this gorilla, now it's a new gorilla. You know, but it's never been, to say that's never been observed in person, it hasn't. They're going off, like I said, the fossils, similarities, stuff like that. It does take a, like I said, lack of a better term, a little bit of leap of faith. It depends on how open you are to it. I think if you want to find flaws in it, you're going to find flaws in it. And if you want to find truths in it, you're going to find truth.
I'm just addressing the fundamental, the underlying premise of Darwin, which is the randomness is what is used to explain.
I think it's because it's like a mutation, like an animal's born with a mutation. If that mutation doesn't serve its environment, it will die off. But if it does, it will continue to carry those genes, and that will create a new species. I think that's the general theory. It doesn't necessarily mean every time there's an animal born of something a little different, hey, that's a new thing now.
Yeah,
I'm
just contrasting that to what is actually observed in nature. And I've read plenty of peer-reviewed papers and stuff on this type of thing. One example is like a type of snake, a species of snake that was ended up on this particular island, and it was observed that through a very short span of time that the snake had some drastic morphological changes, and that it started out like they'd only get as long as like a foot long or something like that. I'm just kind of just,
yeah, it's kind of island-like dwarfism.
Yeah, then it observed after being on the island for about 20 years, some odd years, that the population of snakes were obviously would grow to a longer length. And then it was like an example of adaptation that happened very rapidly. And that sort of thing is observed. Now, it will be held up as an example of snake evolution. But that's not vast aeons of time. It's not anything indicative of a slow accumulation of imperceptible changes.
So your issue is with the time. You're saying your issue is saying that Darwin made it sound like it would take tons and tons of time, and this is taking a short amount of time.
Well, if it's taking a short amount of time and that's what's being observed, then the mechanism is fundamentally different than what's proposed, is what I'm saying. I'm saying that since they don't know what 98% of the DNA does, and they're finding out that they're regulatory genes. That in order, in other words, they don't they're not instrumental in creating proteins that create morphological structures. They're more of like sets of instructions on how the protein synthesizing genes react. Or create different changes or adaptations, and that's what they're finding out with this so-called ENCODE project. Now, this is what's out there in the literature and out there on the web. Anybody can look this ENCODE project up, and this is not Darwin's theory, man. This is something that's saying, well, life is more complicated than we thought. These adaptations are observed to happen rapidly. The Lenski experiment actually proves the opposite of what Darwin claimed. Now, and they're going to claim that this is an example of the E. coli bacteria evolving. But what's has been demonstrated in other experiments is that you can bring along these adaptations rapidly because they exist in the genome already, and they're just being switched on and off. And it's like, that's not Darwin. That's demonstrating something else. But see, it gets conflated with Darwin, and that's because the scientists in this organizational culture that's been established that you have to pay obeisance or fealty to this idea, and that these observations and these experiments have to be shoehorned into Darwin's theory, or you're out of the deal. And it's this culture that's been established within this cult of science, the establishment science, that it's well understood too that if you don't toe the line and you're not pushing Darwinism, that you're out of the club. There's exceptions to that, but I think it's pretty well established that if you don't shoehorn your interpretation, your observations into that Darwinistic interpretation, then you're not playing the game right. And they know which side their bread is buttered on. They don't buck against the system, and it's pretty glaringly obvious at this point, I think.
Right, and as like the opposite of that, do you find there's money to be made in religion?
Of course.
Okay.
Of course.
I'm just wondering. So just out of general curiosity, without talking about like what you don't believe in, I'm just curious. Like, what do you think the history of life is like? Through the years, or if you don't know, that's fine. Because I find that to be an acceptable answer. Like, you're still thinking it's up for debate, or do you have a general idea?
I think that. Life has this ability to adapt, and that more speaks to the underlying complexity that's there. I don't understand it. I don't know if I buy into all the claims that I've heard things too, that DNA is not the end all be all for how things are developed. There's other observations that have been made that are sort of set on the back burner. There's a lot of different things, but I think that is something that is universally agreed on. Even Dawkins said this. He said things do appear to be designed, but then he'll contend that they're not, that they're a product of random occurrences.
Right. But what do you think?
I think that the reason why things look designed is because they are designed, and they are designed by an intelligence.
Okay, and with that said, you agree, again, I'm getting hung up on this word species, but do you agree there are, let's just say, types? There are types, many types of animals that don't exist anymore. I'm not just talking about trilobites, I'm talking about...
I don't know what that means. When you say types, you have to define types.
I don't want to say species because I feel like that's another issue we're having, but I'll just say species, different species, animals that don't look like the ones we have today. Do you agree that they don't exist anymore? Like giant terror birds and giant ground sloths, just stuff that's drastically different than what we have.
Yeah, but you're talking about a matter of physical size. Like, were things maybe bigger in the past?
So you're saying that they could be...
grown larger.
Comparable to like a Paraceratheum or something like an Andrew Sarkis. Like, they're just so different than what we have today, it would be hard for me to say that this is just a smaller version of a sheep because it's just so drastically different. Yeah. I guess my point is this: if we're going to contend that these things don't exist anymore, why why would they be made? Why would things be made and then have them go away and then kind of new things be made? Like, what's the point of all that?
Well, I don't even know if that is true. If there's like all these animals that existed in the past that are fundamentally distinct from the types of animals we see today, that's not what Stephen Jay Gould proposed when he came up with the theory of punctuated equilibrium. Now, if you listen to what he's saying there, he's saying that you go back in the fossil record, and what we find predominantly is stasis in the record. So what he said, and he was a preeminent evolutionary biologist. He died in the 90s. He was sort of a Richard Dawkins type, but with actual credentials which I would contend he was a lot more knowledgeable than Dawkins. But he came up with, him and Niles Eldridge came up with punctuated equilibrium. It was to explain what was observed in the fossil record, which was stasis. And then he proposed punctuated equilibrium to explain that how evolution happens in sort of fits and starts, where one type goes to a different type, but rapidly and in a way that really doesn't leave much of a trace. So it's sort of an ad hoc explanation for why the fossil record doesn't support Darwinism. And he just comes up with a new theory. He still believed in it because he's a true believer. So it's like this matter of faith. It's not so if what I contend is that this belief system is not evidentiary based. It's not evidence based. So why would I expect it to shake Stephen Jay Gould's faith? It wouldn't. But he needed to explain what he was. So he was intellectually honest, at least on one level, where he had to come to terms with what the observations were. Now what you'll fast forward 2017, and what Darwinists and evolution proponents of evolution theory will contend is that in the last couple of decades we've adequately filled in the gaps. And I reject that. I said, okay, 150 years they've been looking for these fossils, and you mean to tell me within the last couple of decades they've filled in all these gaps, which is what Darwin proposed, that what you should find is in the fossil record, if you believe in common descent, is
essentially a missing link. Missing links to things, is that what you're saying?
Just transitions between all these different animal types. So Stephen Jay Gould said that's not what you see in the fossil record. That's why punctuated equilibrium exists.
I think it's like, well, the theories of evolution would be so subtle sometimes that it would be hard to pinpoint this thing specifically spawned these things. There are some examples, like I said, there's so many different species that are discovered. There's like evolutionary dead ends. So when you say you don't know if these things didn't exist, there are things that there are no modern counterparts to, so clearly they don't exist anymore, unless you're just saying that the fossils are just, they're making up what they're finding. I mean, it depends on how little you believe these people. I mean, I didn't want to go the dinosaur route because I feel that's the easy way to go, but in this case, you know, dinosaurs, there's nothing like dinosaurs. Like, there's nothing like a T-Rex, there's nothing like the velociraptor, these things. So there's clearly been things that are, the Earth looked quite different at one point in time.
Mm-hmm. We've went over
these animals didn't exist.
How rare they are to find those, right?
They are rare, but it doesn't mean they didn't exist because they're not rare. Because they're rare, something could be rare and still be exist. I mean, there's something called an Andrewsuchus, which is the largest land carnivore to ever exist. There's one skull of this thing.
Yeah,
there's literally one skull.
I've heard also too that there's only like a dozen skeletons of complete dinosaurs. Like typically,
they
like
fill
they'll
the
find. Yeah, and then they sort of construct the skeleton out of these fragments that they find. Like the first ever dinosaur was what the
I believe it was a megalosaurus.
No, it was the iguanodon.
Okay.
That was the first ever dinosaur, and what was it? The scientists have found out it was like 5 teeth. That's what he had. That's what he had to work with. So out of these five teeth, they devised this iguanodon creature. And
it's an educated guess.
I just don't have a lot of faith in that ability. You know, it's like it. You know, especially when you go look at like the Piltdown Man and Nebraska Man that were later dismissed as frauds. But see, the Piltdown Man was evolutionary showcased for 40 years before it was
it was really
a ham-handed fraud of taking a pig's tooth and filing it down, putting it in an ape's jaw, and it's really crude, but it's a full it stood its ground for 40 years in the so-called peer review of the culture of scientists. So I mean then people would say, well, see, there's an example where, oh, if there is fraud, they'll be found out. And it's like, well, that takes a lot of faith to take that position because it went on for 40 years without being found out. So you'd have to take the position.
I'd be interested in looking into that. I'm not familiar with that, I'll be honest.
Oh, Piltdown Man? Yeah, you got to look at that.
Piltdown Man?
And that was also in the... It was brought out in the Scopes trial as some of the best evidence for evolution theory, and that was supposedly a sort of a pivotal trial that sort of helped to catapult forward the idea that if you don't believe in evolution, you're sort of backward and a hayseed, and yeah, it's like, oh, we got this built down, man, and you're an idiot if you don't believe
it.
I
don't really
feel
it's productive in any way to insult people.
Well, I mean, if you have much experience trying to argue the other side of evolutionary base, like you,
I don't.
One of the things that I've experienced very early and often in any kind of, and you're not doing it, and I appreciate that, but it's like just the ad hominem attacks that you get just relentlessly.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of that.
Yeah, and that's very common, though. I mean, go to the evolution experience thing, and then they have that show posted up on their blog, and it's like, yeah, this guy's an idiot, he's a conspiracy theorist and a jackass and blah blah blah, not addressing any of the points I made, but just calling me names. But
well, like
it's pretty common.
You know what I mean, you could definitely argue that it's a productive conversation, because even if you think the person you're talking to is completely wrong, it could inspire you to find answers. And I think, you know, I do believe there's scientists in the field looking for answers every day. It's lack of a better term, it's an evolving process.
Yeah, and it's really compartmentalized. All the sciences are very sort of fragmented into different specialized fields. Like, you know, I'm a, like Ken Miller, like he was telling me, like, yeah, I'm pretty much a plant biologist.
Yeah, they all.
And I was
going to
ask him, like, so how are you an expert on monkeys? But anyway, I guess it don't matter. Yeah. He's a biologist, and he's making a claim based on this observation, which I guess he has every right to do, and he's claimed to be peer-reviewed, and I don't know exactly what that means, but I believe that a lot of people have this belief in this thing called peer review that's not substantiated either. Like, they believe that it's sort of this, this sort of gold standard of arriving at truth, and there's a lot of stuff even in the peer review literature that refutes that. I mean, I have a bunch of articles that, the editor of the Lancet Journal, one of the most preeminent medical journals on the planet. Like the editor, the head guy, says that half of all the crap we get in here is false. Half of the peer reviewed stuff is false. It's like, wow, that's a pretty profound, earth-shattering revelation by the editor. But see, you're not even going to hear about that stuff, because I think that it's sort of this modern mythology that gets perpetuated by these science populists like Neil deGrasse Tyson and Lawrence Krauss and stuff like that. Every time they have a chance, they're going to get in front of an audience and they're going to say, well, see, we scientists are different. Like, we're pretty much the thing that drives us forward is facts and evidence. And it's like, well, dude, you need to establish that with some proof that you have this special immunity from bias that everybody else has, and that you're claiming that, you know, everybody that's religious has and everybody else. But they can just come out and assert that and not have any evidence to back that up.
Right.
Which that's
when you say you believe in a designer, you're not specifically talking about like in a Christian sect. You mean like a vague type of thing.
I don't rule out the see God as far as a Christian conceptualization of God is that it's a personal God, a God that has attributes that are like self-awareness, consciousness, has its own God has his own independent identity and sovereignty and free will on its own. Yeah, I think that God would have to be something along that order. It's something like that's has all the abilities and the ability to, but far beyond mankind. Something that cause and the laws of cause and effect.
Right.
That it's established. That is a law in science.
Yeah.
It necessitates that any effect, any cause must be greater than its. Subsequent effect.
But Christianity has existed far less time than humans have.
Well, I don't think belief in a creator God has.
No. Almost every civilization has had some type of belief in God, but I think they're kind of, some of them are pretty similar, but some of them are kind of different. There was like Odin, Zeus,
yeah.
The Mayans had their beliefs, yeah, it's sex. So it is an interesting social thing of like society, why people always come up with the same idea. It's definitely that could be a completely different topic altogether, but
yeah, there is religious precursors to Darwin's theory as well, where you have the Vedic text and I'm not good with these Hindu names or all that, but I'd have to look it up.
Just Hinduism,
but yeah.
I will pretty much have to wrap this up. I have to get up in like 4 hours, but...
Okay.
All right, man. Yeah. But an interesting conversation. I appreciate the time.
Well, yeah, I think it was good. I mean, I think, I understand that a lot of people believe in evolution theory, and I appreciate you coming on and discussing it. What would you leave as sort of your final word on the subject?
Well, like I said, it's given me something to think about, different, I'll put it this way, not necessarily, I still believe in evolution, but it's an alternative way of thinking, and if anything, like I said, it kind of leads you to find the answers, the problems you're having with it.
Mm-hmm.
that could challenge people to look for these answers. And like I said, I think it's constantly evolving. And I will say, even though I do believe in it, I do think that there's a lot that scientists don't know. I still think there's a lot of mysteries behind it. And I think there's a lot of work to be done. I don't think it's like a settled thing.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot to discover. I think the truth is out there. And I'm 500 years from now, who knows where we'll be at. But definitely... I'll see. I'll probably have some people listen to it, see what they think. I'll get feedback.
Yeah, or maybe I would like to leave everybody with this: is like consider the possibility that maybe it is just another belief system among belief systems, and that just because it's got the science label on it doesn't necessarily it was the conclusions were arrived at through some strict adherence to the so-called scientific method, because it doesn't necessarily mean, because there's this association with it, that the association is warranted. That's another thing too. It's like it's commonly understood logical fallacy to make associations between certain things like engineering or your computer with Darwin's theory, because they're both come out of the so-called sciences. And that
right. I see what you're saying.
It's a common fallacy that's not doesn't really substantiate a separate independent claims of science, So I just throw it out there. I I think that if you start looking at it from that perspective and challenge yourself to establish the premise that it's based on, you know, that the scientific establishment is immune from biases enough to where it backs up those claims by, you know, science populists, or what's commonly put out there is like they're mainly concerned with conclusions that are based on facts. If you challenge that premise, I think you can come to some different conclusions, you know. So I
right.
like to kind of focus it in that direction, because you can go down all the list of claims, and it's just endless. You know, the peer review papers out there that supposedly established Darwin, and they're just too numerous to even mention. But if you go to the underlying premise, then it's like you need to probably establish that first, and then how solid does all that evidence claim? Because, you know, the Mormons too, they have archaeological digs and texts and manuscripts in an overwhelming abundance. So just keep that in mind too. It's like, if that establishes something as true, you know, the argument for verbosity, we have all these texts, we have all these claims, we have all these digs, we have all these rocks and artifacts and stuff like that, then if that is what you use to establish something as true, then you might as well become a Mormon as you would a believer in modern naturalistic materialism or Darwinism. Hmm. Or so, yeah.
That's one way of putting it.
Yeah, I think that's where I wanted to kind of focus in on, is kind of the also examining the premise. So, but yeah, this is could go on and on, but I know you got to take off. So thank you again, and maybe we could do it again sometime.
Yeah, sure. No problem. Okay. Thank you.
Appreciate it, man. Have a good night.
You too.